Thank you. Thank you. Talking early in the morning about, you know, shaking people out of complacency and a wake up. What do you think is the message from your situation? I mean, not the misinformation side, but the fact that you could be in the situation like this. What do you want to do?
I infected a couple people by the time I was home. And out of the three people that I infected, I had hands down the worst symptoms. The others, trivial symptoms. They just survived them just fine, no problems. You can't bet on what kind of symptoms you'll get. And if you're asymptomatic, you cannot have any concept of how much damage you might cause somebody else by passing it on and then having these awful symptoms. You don't get to choose. This isn't just like the regular flu that, oh, I might get a bit of a headache and a runny nose. I got literally the full gambit, and I'm supposed to be peak health.
Well, may you return to peak health, and very thankful that you are early recovery, and thankful for the time today you delivered such an important message, and it's a pleasure to talk to you here. We'll keep in touch. Wish you all the best.
Thanks so much.
Thanks. Countries around the world are now rallying to help India battle its ever-worsening COVID crisis. The UK, among the countries pitching in with that medical equipment, the medical oxygen. oxygen you're seeing right there. Canada is also offering to pitch in, saying it's exploring all options to help. But as of yet, India has not asked for assistance directly from Canada. The country has set a global record for infections for a fifth straight day, well over 300,000 cases.
I don't know government is sleeping or what they are doing. I am totally disheartened in the situation which I am seeing. Government is a literal failure. One person cannot live. Stay here in Delhi. A person cannot even die peacefully in Delhi.
In the capital, the estimate is one person is dying every 4 minutes. The Prime Minister, Narendra Modi, calls it coronavirus a catastrophe storm that is battering this country. It's been described as a tsunami. It's been worrying about being described as something that is swallowing people. That is how quickly it's moving from the population. Mish Angola, in Florida, is once again with us from New Delhi. He's a very nice journalist there, and he's been reporting live for us through these past recent days. Let's go through the latest numbers, if we could, the latest details, Mish and all the crisis, and the international aid that has begun to arrive.
Well, more than 350,000 cases of COVID-19 have once again in the country. Another milestone, and more than 2,800 deaths only in the past 24 hours. This is the biggest daily tally for India as well, the death tally. And at this day, we need better international assistance to start trickling in. Singapore was actually one of the first countries to offer this sort of assistance. In the past few weeks, India started airlifting empty oxygen tankers from Singapore when the oxygen crisis in the country started to worsen. And in the past few weeks, the country has also airlifted oxygen from Singapore. Now, the United States also countered India's aid. President Joe Biden has said that they are sending over medical equipment, going from ventilators to new testing kits and PPE kits and oxygen concentrators to India. Health experts here are saying that America is actually sitting on a pile of the AstraZeneca vaccines in hundreds of millions. That's something that could be used for a war because those vaccines are on the critical usage in the US. That's why they are one of the vaccines that we have. So that's something that the health experts are asking for. At the same time, other countries like Canada and
Ishan, we've heard a little bit in the introduction to you the criticism that is growing, really, of the Modi government's handling of this crisis. And we're also hearing about anger because the government has ordered Twitter to remove posts that are critical of its handling. So bring us up to speed on that part of the story, the criticism that the government is now really beginning to face publicly.
Well, the first thing really is that a lot of people, because they feel that the government has failed them, are taking to Twitter, hoping to find a good society. They're asking for help in all sorts of ways. They're looking for hospital beds, for oxygen, for even plasma donations. So Twitter is really that people are looking for at the moment, calling for help. So if
thank you. expanding the role of its border agency, Frontex, giving it a greater mandate to send back migrants to their countries of origin. Brussels says that, as it stands, it does not return enough unauthorized migrants, and only a fraction of those who are denied residency in the bloc are sent home. Christopher Pitchers reports.
Increasing and better managing the voluntary return of migrants. This is the aim of the Commission's strategy proposed Tuesday, as the institution admits that this particular aspect of its migration policy is a failure.
It is not a secret that the European Union did not do particularly well on returns so far. In 2019, about 500,000 people had received return orders and only 142,000 were actually returned. That means that we're managing roughly one-third of those who should be.
The Commission is proposing to cooperate more with partner countries like Turkey, with the intention of appointing a coordinator in charge of returning migrants. Frontex, the EU's border agency, will also get a new mandate to deal with these returns. But for the European Council on Refugees and Exiles, the announcement is particularly worrying.
That comes at a time where Frontex is facing investigations and scrutiny due to allegations and violations that it has witnessed or has been involved in. So it's very risky to give additional roles to Frontex, particularly in third countries, where Frontex operations tend to be quite opaque, and where there is a risk that Frontex runs a sort of parallel foreign policy.
The organisation also says that voluntary returns are preferable to forced returns. But the Commission points out that this solution requires fewer resources. The forced return is valued at over €3,000, compared to over €500 for a migrant who decides to voluntarily return. Christopher Pitchers, Euronews, Brussels.
Albania's Prime Minister Edi Rama has claimed victory in Sunday's election, describing his win as historic. The Electoral Commission says Rama's Socialist Party has taken 74 seats in the 140-seat parliament, which will see them govern alone. With 95% of votes counted, the main opposition Democratic Party are
just an only four in a great big
59 seats. Rama has urged the opposition to concede defeat, but has offered to collaborate with them to carry out modernizing reforms. The United Nations is hosting 3 days of informal talks on the future of the divided Mediterranean island of Cyprus. Foreign ministers from Greece, Turkey, and Britain are joining delegations from the Greek Cypriot and Turkish Cypriot communities in Geneva. Correspondent Efi Kuzukusta says expectations of progress are low as both sides are struggling to find common ground.
These meetings are quite crucial, of course, to show where these talks are going if we take into consideration that both parties are very far apart, especially what they want to be the solution. And one diplomatic source told me earlier that Antonio Guterres has many options on the table. One option is even to postpone the plenary, which is scheduled tomorrow for all parties to be on the same table, and even to extend the meeting to Friday. Of course, everything depends on how the talks will go. And as I told you before, both parties, the Greek Cypriots and Turkish Cypriots, is the first time after many years that they are so much far apart. And this is because, on the one hand, we have the Greek Cypriots, supported by the Greek government, who insist to the UN framework, which is based on the solution of a bi-zonal, bi-communal federation for an island which can be reunified sometime soon, they hope. On the other hand, we have Ersin Tatar, the new Turkish Cypriot leader, who came together with the Turkish foreign minister, and they are coming with some new demands. They want a two-state solution. It's the first time in many years that this comes to the table. And for some analysts, it's a kind of a pressure from the Turkish Cypriot, Turkish side, to just secure some further concessions, especially when it comes to energy sharing.
So this has been an issue for a very long time. What seems to be the main sticking points in these talks?
The main sticking points, we could say, include are sharing by the two communities. Of course, this is an issue which will come on the table if they agree on this reunification with the island solution. Then you have, of course, the property issue, which is very important for many citizens of the island that have lost their properties many, many decades ago, and other issues, but these are some of the most, let's say, controversial.
India has reported another 320,000 new coronavirus cases as the country's healthcare system struggles to keep up with the worsening crisis. With hospitals full in the capital, New Delhi, authorities are converting hotels and even train carriages to treat patients. But shortages of medical supplies have meant some people with severe COVID-19 can't be treated. Health workers say they are overwhelmed.
I get maybe around 50 calls every day. Somebody asking for beds, somebody asking for cylinders, somebody asking for drugs. We don't have anything available, and patients are dying.
The medicines which were getting helpful in the earlier last week, which used to give in the mild cases, it doesn't seem to work now.
This pandemic is the worst we have ever seen so far. And these 2 weeks are going to be a hell for us.
Foreign shipments of vital medical supplies have started pouring into the country. The UK has sent 100 ventilators, while France is delivering 8 oxygen generators, each providing enough supply for several hundred hospital beds. And India will receive the largest share of the 60 million AstraZeneca vaccines being sent from the US. Even China, which has been locked in a military standoff on its Himalayan border with India, says it's willing to help. U.S. health officials have relaxed guidelines on face masks, saying fully vaccinated people can forego wearing the protective gear outside. Those who are inoculated will be able to unmask at small outdoor gatherings or when dining outside with friends, although a mask is recommended for crowded outdoor events. The new guidance is another step towards a return to normality for the country that has given a first vaccine dose to half of its adult population. Facebook, Twitter, and YouTube have testified before a U.S. Senate hearing on their platform's algorithms and how they contribute to the spread of misinformation. Matthew DeCube has more.
We may all be familiar with scrolling through social media platforms like Instagram, and when you scroll through the content that you like and follow, eventually at the bottom of your page, you will be shown suggested content. These are posts that Instagram think you will be interested
in. Please
enter
your password.
Then you also click like and follow these accounts. This is all driven by an algorithm. Similarly, you may remember on any social media platform, YouTube, on the right-hand side of your screen, after you finish watching a video that you've clicked on, you will be suggested another video. But again, YouTube thinks you will be interested in watching. These algorithms are designed to keep users on the platform, to keep them scrolling as part of their social networks, business, and marketing model. Now, there's obviously a good side to this, because, for example, if on Instagram you're scrolling through wellness content, you might be suggested other accounts that you'd be interested in and can be of benefit. But there are now concerns that these type of algorithms are also pushing people towards more harmful content. Well, now for the first time, algorithms are becoming the sole focus of a hearing inside the US Senate judiciary. Executives from Facebook, Twitter, and YouTube are all being called to testify in front of United States lawmakers. Because for months now, Democrats, as well as organizations and analysts, have been expressing concerns these algorithms on social media are pushing people towards hate speech, extremist content, and even misinformation about coronavirus vaccines. Earlier, I spoke to Callum Hood, who's head of research at the Center for Countering Digital Hate, and he told me more about their concerns.
We carried out a study looking at people who follow, for example, wellness influencers, and we found that Instagram's algorithm was actually pushing to them vaccine misinformation and COVID misinformation. And given that we're in a pandemic, that is a huge problem which could actually prolong the pandemic, prolong the crisis that we're in.
Now, it's worth noting that the chief executives of Twitter, Facebook, and YouTube will not be testifying at this hearing, but it is certainly a significant move in the United States. And of course, here in Europe as well, authorities are moving close to trying to regulate exactly what happens when we use mobile technology and social media platforms.
EU lawmakers are poised to vote on the post-Brexit agreements between the European Union and the UK.
Hi, Paul.
I'm pretty sure I told you last night, but Donna Walden books is Kathy Yeager, Eileen Yeager's daughter. She lived in New Mexico. For a while, she lived in an adobe hut. And then, I don't know, maybe she moved. We weren't close as children. I don't know what to say, but Donna Wadenbos revealed that she's Kathy Yeager, Y-E-A-G-E-R, Scott's sister, Kim Yeager's sister, Don Yeager's daughter. He killed himself when I was 5. We still lived at the house on Osborne Road. So, Donna Wadenbos is Kathy Yeager. Whatever you want. Screen is so small. And it's too complicated. I can't think it through, God. I'd rather take a nap. I feel better. Just gonna sit. I did, didn't I? I never did. I wanna sit there, right? Could you not push me? I sat the alarm. I'm gonna relax for a while.
Tonight, Human Rights Watch accuses Israel of crimes of apartheid and persecution, something the country strongly denies. Next, we'll speak to the NGO about what they found.
This week on Euro News.
Aix-Marseille. Aix-en-Provence to Marseille is one of the busiest transport routes in France. There's a new transport hub making the journey easier. Here in Gardanne, trains, buses and non-polluting vehicles now share the same space to meet the demand for more than 500,000 commuters a year. A transport hub supported by the European Cohesion Policy. Find out more this week on Smart Regions on Euronews and Euronews.com.
Good things come to those who work. So let's get to work. Get going. Get busted.
Let's go make this money, man.
Let's get paid. Not late. Yeah. Because there are things we want. Yeah. Goals to reach. Yeah. Ideas to create. Yeah. And there's no better time. Yeah. So what are you waiting for? Pick up, drop off, dash out. Dash now. DoorDash.
I never wanted to come to this.
others who have supported me, who have been by my side.
The woman who killed her abusive husband in Turkey and was just freed has eyes like Debbie Katz. The high eyebrow area.
The move provoked a furious reaction from campaigners within Turkey and widespread international condemnation, including from the EU. Judith Prescott, Euronews.
A new report from Human Rights Watch claims Israel is committing crimes against humanity of apartheid and persecution against Arabs in the occupied territory and Israel itself. Israel's foreign ministry has rejected the report as preposterous and false. Let's bring in Eric Goldstein, acting director for the Middle East at Human Rights Watch. Thank you, Eric, for joining us here during this tonight. So why have you reached this conclusion, calling it crimes against humanity?
We know it's a sensitive word. We don't take it lightly. It took us a long time to reach this conclusion. We're using the legal sense of the term. It's not an analogy to South Africa or anywhere else. And it refers to a system of domination by one people over another, systematic discrimination, and inhumane acts that are committed for that purpose. And we found that all three of those elements of the crime are present in the occupied territories, and that there's also intention to dominate for the benefit of Jewish people at the expense of Palestinians throughout the entire land.
Couldn't security reasons be behind many of Israel's actions?
I think there are three illusions here. One of them is that the actions that we described in the report are all unfortunately necessary due to security. Yes, Israel has real security concerns. But many of the policies that it enacts that vastly undermine the rights of Palestinians are taken well beyond any effort to try to balance individual rights against Israel's security needs. And some of these policies that are just discriminatory on their face or involve land grabs are taken clearly for the purpose of demographic domination or for the purpose of favoring Jewish people over the Palestinians and not really for security reasons. Another of the conclusions is that the peace process is about to bear fruit and not to put the other way in human rights abuses because they'll be cleared up once we have a peace solution. That has been the illusion for 30 years. And the third illusion is that it's just a situation of occupation, and that's unfortunate. The occupation, if we're not on the morning after,
to see Israel put in its place.
And it's time for the people who live under occupation, who lived under it for two generations, to begin to enjoy equal rights.
Well, Eric, we have to say, though, that Israel has strongly denied your report. But what are you hoping that Israel will take away from your findings?
Well, they have not contested a single fact in the report yet. But I think what we would like to see happen is to raise the price of the status quo. The situation right now is intolerable. It's an offense to basic notions of the right of all people to benefit under the law. And that
Carla Pixels is the important people she knows in Israel torture infants and children.
The plight of the Palestinians, the Israeli-Palestinian conflict, has not even been mentioned. It's just accepted as a tolerable situation, and we think that the Israeli public and the international community should recenter human rights. Whatever your objectives are in the peace process, two states, one state, confederation, human rights have to be at the center.
I don't know if this is enforceable.
Eric Goldstein there from Human Rights Watch. Thank you so much for joining us here at Your News.
Thank you.
1 in 10 women has had a miscarriage in their lifetime. That's more than 23 million worldwide.
Human Rights Watch has accused Israel of apartheid, which is selectively oppressing a group. Crimes against humanity.
Thank you.
I'd love to see all of them in pain. Suffering, deformed, everything. There wouldn't be anything. I don't think I'd cry, I might throw up. Magical Ellen wants to be me, can't figure out how to do it. Harry says he ended his soul for the state of Israel. Harry says the Vatican ended its soul for the state of Israel. I'm gonna upload this and then lay down and watch TV, I guess.